Yes, same, same. Good morning, Jagtap sir. Jagtap sir, good morning.
Good morning, good morning, good morning.
Good morning, very good. We are all waiting for you, Vijay Joshi sir. Principal Rathod is waiting for you.
Yeah. I am joining just now. So it is NAC induction program, no?
Yes, sir. Good this morning.
Is... Hello, Joshi sir. Namaste.
Sir. Namaskar, namaskar, Jagtap sir. Namaskar.
Namaskar, namaskar, namaskar.
Jagtap sir. Jagtap sir, a revised AQR to Navin format alela hai, tachyavarti faculty development program hai.
Okay.
I mean, it is 6 days program.
Okay.
The organizer will tell in brief in advance, begin with.
Okay. Yeah. So, all are the IQC coordinators?
IQC coordinators and the principals of some of the colleges, but mainly IQC coordinators.
Okay. Okay, no issues.
And there are about 500 participants on YouTube, about 500 on the main platform.
Okay.
It was inaugurated by our director Rusa on first day.
Okay.
And the concept note was given by Principal Joshi.
Okay.
Followed by there are various speakers.
Okay.
We already had Vani Lathurkar madam. We had Sri Hari Pingle.
Yeah. Previous speakers, no? Last year's speakers.
Yes. Okay. Same. Our good team is. We have a very good team.
Yeah.
आणि शेवटच्या दिवशी गणेश इकडे येतात डॉक्टर गणेश इकडे उद्या थोडा वेळ यांना रिक्वेस्ट केले आपले जॉईंट डायरेक्टर मुंबई रिजन
मलगेंना
केले
पार्टिसिपेंट मुंबई युनिव्हर्सिटीचे आहेत का अक्रॉस द महाराष्ट्र
अक्रॉस द महाराष्ट्र
सर अक्रॉस द महाराष्ट्र ओके
Manjushi madam.
Yes, sir.
We will be starting sharp at 10:25. The program will start begin exactly at 10:30 so that the joint director will be there for address us, right?
Yes, and sir. Then yes,
meanwhile,
sir.
Deepak Nana will join, right?
Yes, sir. Bye.
For the understanding to of our guest of honor today, Manjushi madam, थोडं ब्रीफ करा आधी सर 2 दिवसांमध्ये 3 दिवसांमध्ये काय झालं त्या दिवशी
ओके फाईन सर या ओके सो बेसिकली वी हॅव प्लॅन्ड दिस एफडीपी टू अक्वेंट द पार्टिसिपेंट्स विथ द रिवाइज्ड एक्यूआर गाईडलाईन्स विच विल बी इम्प्लिमेंटेड फ्रॉम 2020-21 दॅट इज दिस अकॅडमिक इयर as Babrekar sir has said, the participants are principals, IQAC coordinators, and even teaching faculty members who are maybe part of IQAC team in their colleges all over Maharashtra. And this program is organized in collaboration with RUSA. On the first day of this particular FDP, we had the inauguration of this FDP. Chief guest was Mr. Pankaj Kumar, the IAS officer, and Dr. Vijay Joshi was the keynote speaker. On the first day, Dr. Vani Lathurkar madam gave a general overview about NAC, its functioning processes, and AQAR, importance of AQAR. Then on the second day, we had sessions by Mr. Sri Hari Pingle sir, and he covered criterion number 2 and criterion number
1 and 5.
And today we are going to have Dr. Deepak Nanavare sir, who will be throwing light upon criterion number 2. So we have divided criterion all over this 6 days. And on the last day of this particular FDP, as sir has said, we have invited Dr. Ganesh Hegde from NAC as the chief guest. Dr. Vijay Joshi also will give his comments. Dr. P.N. Pabrekar will give his inputs. And we hope to reach out to maximum number of people. So that's why along with our Zoom application, we are also going to have the live streaming on YouTube. And in our Zoom meeting, we have approximately 350 to 400 participants. And yesterday, for our YouTube, there were around 480 viewers. So I think we are reaching out to people. And this is definitely going to help all the participants, because each one of us are working on IQAC, working on NAC and NAC assessment in their respective colleges. And under the guidance of RUSA, we are, definitely going to gain a lot out of this kind of an FDP. So this was the intention of organizing the FDP.
Manjusha madam.
Bindu madam.
Sorry, Deepak Nanavare sir has joined.
Yeah, he is already there. Bindu madam, Deepak
yes,
Nanavare,
yes.
Dr. Deepak Nanavare sir has joined. So please make him co-host.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah, Deepak yes. Nanavare. Good morning, Deepak.
Good morning, sir. I am speaking with sir. He will join in 5 minutes.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, all right. All right. All right.
Okay.
Manjusha madam, we can start the program.
Okay. Fine, sir. Fine.
Because when it will take 5 minutes over, so that by the time we join, so everything will be covered.
Fine. Fine. So, Varsha madam.
Yes, Reena, unmute, please. Reena, madam.
Just a minute. She.
Bindu, just check if she is the co-host.
She joined from the second
level.
Yeah.
Hello,
yes,
Serena.
Yes, she said.
Yeah. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Thank you. Am I audible now, ma'am?
Yes. Yes, Serena.
Yes. So, good morning, one and all. Esteemed dignitaries, guest of honor, Dr. Sanjay Jagtap, sir, the office bearers of RUSA, Dr. Vijay Joshi, sir, and Dr. P. N. Pabrikar, sir, resource persons for the FDP, Professor Dr. Vani Laturkar, Dr. Bharat Kankude, and Mr. Srihari Pingre. Today's resource person, Dr. Deepak Nanavare, principal of our college, Professor Dr. S. V. Rathod, and teaching fraternity from various colleges across the state. On behalf of Bhavans Hazarimal Sowani College of Arts and Science and Jairam Das Patel College of Commerce and Management Studies, I, Reena Patel, heartily welcome you all to the third day of this 1 week faculty development program titled NAC, AQAR submission in the revised format, organized in collaboration with Rashtriya Uchchatar Shiksha Abhiyan, RUSA, Maharashtra. Today we shall have detailed learning and discussion about criterion 2, teaching, learning and evaluation. It's indeed our pleasure to have amongst us today Dr. Sanjay Jagtap, Joint Director, Panvel Region, as the guest of honor for the day. I now call upon IQSC member Dr. Varsha Palla to introduce today's guest of honor.
Thank you, Reena ma'am. A very good morning to one and all. It is my proud privilege to introduce Dr. Sanjay Jagtap, Joint Director, Higher Education, Konkan Region, Panvel. Dr. Sanjay Jagtap has a vast experience of working in various professional and academic bodies. His long journey of working includes an enormous experience of working on various academic bodies like the Board of Studies in Forensic Science of various universities, including Shivaji University, Kolhapur, RSTM University, Nagpur, Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar Marathwada University, Aurangabad, and University of Mumbai, and as a member of Technical Committee for Institute of Forensic Science, Mumbai and Aurangabad, constituted by Government of Maharashtra. Sir has been member of various important committees over the years. To name a few, he was a member of Minor Research Project Scrutiny Committee, University of Mumbai, New College Proposal Scrutiny Committee, University of Mumbai, member of CAS Scrutiny Committee in various aided and government colleges, member of Extension of Retirement Age for Professors Scrutiny Committee, University of Mumbai and SNDT University. Sir is also a member of editorial board for World Journal of Pharmaceutical Science. Sir has delivered over 30 invited talks on various topics ranging from autonomy of colleges, RUSA, CAS and its amendments, forensic science, NEC, service conditions, biodiversity, drug discovery, and COVID-19 challenges in higher education system. Dr. Jagtap's research experience includes over 25 publications, 2 books, and innovation of gene sequence and registration at NCBI. He has served as Joint Director, Higher Education for Amravati and Pune region. Sir worked as coordinator for Government Institute of Forensic Science and as state coordinator at RUSA Government of Maharashtra. He is an able administrator with 29 years of experience. In this capacity, he is very well known to be approachable, helpful, and very cooperative. We really feel fortunate to have amidst us a speaker of his caliber, and I'm sure his talk will definitely inspire all of us. I now welcome Dr. Sanjay Jagtap, sir, to address this virtual gathering. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Dr. Pabrekar, Dr. Vijay Joshi, all resource person, Dr. Simant Rathore, principal, Hazaribul Somani, Bhavans College Chupati, all the organizers, and all the participants across the state of Maharashtra. So it is my privilege to have the address to the participants. Most of them, they are the IPSC coordinator and the principal of the various colleges. And I'm thankful to RUSA and the organizers, those who organized this FDP program on this important issue, because last many years, we are struggling for the accreditation process. There are so many reasons, ignorance at stakeholders level, the policy makers, and the community, those who are involved in the accreditation process. So NAC Bangalore providing us all the technical help, guidance, software, trainers, mentors, various schemes across the country. Still, we are not achieved that much target, but we are thankful to RUSA Maharashtra, because I am also part and parcel right from the beginning. And last year, Dr. Pabrekar and Dr. Vijay Joshi, along with the team of mentors, we organized workshop on this NAC accreditation and autonomy. And lot of initiative has been taken by the team of RUSA. And that's why, especially Dr. Vijay Joshi and Pabrekar, we are ranked 3rd in the autonomous colleges in the country. And we are bypassing the Andhra Pradesh, only the difference of 2 or 3 colleges. I think 102 colleges in Maharashtra and 105 colleges in the Andhra Pradesh. But I'm sure within upcoming days or within upcoming 2-3 months, we are definitely overcoming the Andhra Pradesh in the autonomy of the colleges. So autonomy and the accreditation is the need of our. In the new education policy, the government has planned within 10 years, so all the colleges become the graded autonomous. They want to disconnect the affiliation system with the university. So new approach is coming up. All the stakeholders has to give their best to made it successful, the new education policy. There are so many hurdles, but we have to overcome these hurdles and we have to accept the challenges created due to this new education policy. And in the upcoming era, in the upcoming days, the accreditation has a very important role. So those who want to survive in the competition, they must have a good accreditation CGPA. And on the basis of the CGPA, the new commission, Higher Education Council Commission, from next academic year is coming up. The merging of AICT and merging of UGC as well as the NAC is also going to be merged. And the centralized bodies come up with the different and definite goals in the higher education system and how to make the new education policy successful. So all the stakeholders should know that the quality consciousness, whatever the criteria laid down by the NAC, so continuously NAC is upgrading the system in the form of the technology, in the form of the quality concern, in the form of teaching learning process, in the form of the examination reforms, in the form of the research and innovation. So all these concepts, those who are coming up, so all these concepts are included in the 7 criteria. But my humble request to all the participants, IQC coordinator and principals, so they should go point to point, and which are our weaknesses. So you have to make your SWOT analysis, and you have to find out the weaknesses of our college, weaknesses of your organization at administrative level, at management level, at teaching and learning process, in the infrastructure, whatever the minor things, the students and co-curricular activities. So all points you have to minutely go through it, and wherever the weaknesses, because every point has the definite credits, and you should not lose the credit on particular point, and you should not lose the grade, because the CGPA is most important assessment tool for the NAC accreditation. And that's why Dr. Ganesh Hegde or Ganesh Hegde and other team of the NAC Bangalore is always helpful. They will come up with all possible help to the participant as well as the IQC coordinator as well as the colleges and the universities. So we have to take the approach. So we have a different scheme under the leadership of the autonomous colleges, and most of the non-grantable colleges, they are not ready for the NAC, and we have to pull them in the main stream of the NAC process. And that's why the Paramar stream was introduced by the NAC Bangalore, and fortunately we have the Paramar Paramar scheme at the Birla College Kalyan in the Konkan region. And we have directed, NAC has directed, as well as RUSA has directed to the Paramarsh colleges, mentor colleges. They are providing the 30 lakh rupees for the training and facilitate the colleges, most of the unaided colleges. And unaided colleges has to take the call. But there are some difficulties, there are some issues with them. And that's why 90%, more than 90% unaided colleges are not facing the NAC. So we have to pull them in the mainstream. So grantable colleges, aided colleges, some of them, they are lagging behind. In the Konkan, only 2 colleges are not facing the NAC due to their difficulties. But I'm sure within 1 or 2 months, they are going to submit the SSR and 100% NAC process is going to be completed. So my humble request to all the participants, most of the IQC coordinator, take in the confidence all the students, all the student bodies, all the teachers of your institution, the help from the other topmost A-graded NAC colleges, take their help. Take their guidance, take the guidance of the RUSA. Both of them, Dr. Joshi and Dr. Pabrekar, are helpful. They are providing all kind of support to the colleges as well as the institutions, and RUSA played a very important role in the last 2 years, and that's why because I'm with the hands in hands with the Mr. Paprikar as well as Dr. Vijay Joshi, and the fruits are going to come because the rank third in the autonomous colleges, it is due to the efforts of the RUSA Maharashtra and the participant and colleges. Okay, so within last 1 year, so my region contribute the 4 colleges, previously 6 colleges, and now it comes to 10 colleges in the Konkan region, those who have become autonomous. So financial help in future is linked with the quality concern, and that's why every college, every institution, they have to face the NAC process with modalities, with the achievements, with the innovative ideas, and we have to impress the NAC peer committee by involving this 7 criteria, and you don't lose any credit, any point in every criteria. So the IQAC coordinator, they should divide these points across their colleagues, and they can have the group discussion. They can call the meeting at the collegiate level, and they have the discussion, PowerPoint presentation to the stakeholders, maybe the student committees or the students or NCC or NSS or sports and other different CDC, and you have to take in confidence every principal, every IQAC coordinator, take in confidence every stakeholder, and they have to convince the stakeholders it is a necessity, it is the need of hour, and the importance of the NAC, how they are linked up with the financial assistance in the upcoming days, because in the new education policy, the new structure is going to come up. And in the new structure, most of the colleges, they come to one umbrella, and all the disciplines, the law discipline or the education discipline and arts, commerce, science, except the medical and agriculture, all the disciplines comes under one umbrella. So how it becomes possible, the times tells us how the difficulties and how we can overcome the difficulty. The government of Maharashtra already constituted the committee under the leadership of the Dr. Suhas Pednekar for the restructuring or the what is the modalities for implementation of the NEP from the next year. So NEP plays very important role, crucial role, because the importance of the university, they are categorized the different kinds of university, teaching learning universities, interdisciplinary universities, then research and innovation universities. And that's why the role of university for the affiliation of the colleges, it becomes less, because the NEP told us all the colleges slowly within a period of 10 years span, it becomes a graded autonomous colleges. And that's why every college across the Maharashtra, whether it is added or whether it is unaided, if you want to survive in the higher education system, you have to quality conscious, and you have to accept the innovative ideas, you have to accept the challenges, and whatever the new criteria constructed by the NAC Bangalore, so everybody should go through it, and you have to achieve some of the modalities, because every college or every stakeholder is not 100% okay. But wherever, just as I told you, you have to make the SWOT analysis of your organization, and you have to find out where the weaknesses, and these weaknesses you have to overcome by having the discussion with the advisors, with the RUSA mentors, or with the Paramarsh team, or NAC Bangalore team, or any other expertise, because we have so many experts, Vanila Turkar, or Dr. Bhole, or other Sonone, so many experts are there. And you are very fortunate, because all these experts last 1 year, they are moving around the states to address the gathering of different university, and lot of pain has been taken by Dr. Pabrekar and Dr. Vijay Joshi to create the awareness across the state of Maharashtra, including all the stakeholders, and university has also played a very important role in the awareness program. And now I'm sure the rest of the Maharashtra, because Bombay and Pune, they are always ahead in accepting the policies of the government of Maharashtra, but the rural area across the state of Maharashtra, they are going to hesitate to accept, but slowly after some time span, they are also ready to accept the for example Shahu College of Latur, or some colleges from the Nasik, some colleges from the Aurangabad, some colleges from the Kolhapur, some colleges from the Satara. So they have come up and they are utilizing whatever the different new ideas, innovating ideas, either it is cluster university, either it is autonomous colleges, either it is research innovation grant, or either it is Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya teachers training program, whatever the new ideas. So all these colleges are coming forward to accept all these new challenges in the higher education system. So this workshop, this FDP is definitely fruitful for all the participants, those who are present directly or those who are joining by the YouTube channel, YouTube mode. So everybody should take the positiveness of the different speakers' idea, and they should move forward. So sure, I'm sure everybody is highlighting the different ideas of the 7 criteria of the NAC. Dr. Ganesh Hegde will also give some tips for you. So because they are involving in the moderating the system of the NAC accreditation, and slowly whatever the shortcomings or whatever the errors and whatever the queries of the stakeholder, they are going to correct it into next version, and every month, every year, the system is going to upgrade it. So this we are also updating ourselves with the ideas, with the quality concern, with the different modalities. It is a guidelines. Whatever the criteria is given, it is just only guideline. So we have to also put our own ideas to again improve the system of the NAC accreditation. And you should make the fruitful. You should make the country top in the higher education system. You should make the state in the top in the higher education system. You should make your university proud to highest number of the autonomous colleges, to highest number of the accredited colleges, not only accredited, but A-grade, topmost colleges. So there should be the race in between the organization, and everybody should think that we have to run fast, we have to win the race in the higher education system. So with this short address, I'm going to conclude. So I am thankful to organizer, I am thankful to Dr. Pabrekar, as well as Dr. Vijay Joshi, who has inviting me as today's chair guest of honor. Thank you very much. Dhanyavaad.
Thank you very much, sir, for this wonderful and really motivating talk. It was indeed very thought-provoking and insightful session, which has helped us to understand NAC as the need of our for our survival, and of course its role and importance in the benchmarking in higher education. Thank you once again, sir.
Thank you.
We now move on to the technical session, and we have with us Dr. Deepak Nanavare to guide us today. Dr. Deepak Nanavare is a professor of English, IQSE coordinator, and head Department of English at DAV Velankar College of Commerce, Solapur. Having teaching experience of 22 years at UG and PG programs, sir has guided 7 students for PhD degree. He is a member of Board of Studies in English and a member of other statutory bodies of Solapur University, various private universities, and various autonomous institutes in Maharashtra. He is a writer of 14 reference books and textbooks. He has delivered expert lectures at the national and international seminars on English language and literature. Sir has also delivered lectures as a resource person for more than 150 seminars, webinars, workshops, FDPs on NAC, revised SSR and AQR filing process, new education policy, and quality enhancement issues in higher education, organized by HRDC, Savitribai Phule University, which was sponsored by RUSA Maharashtra and NAC Bangalore on behalf of IQAC Cluster India. He has also conducted academic and administrative audits of the university departments and colleges affiliated to University of Kolhapur, Solapur, Aurangabad from Maharashtra, and some colleges and universities from Karnataka as well. He has guided colleges as consultant for preparing for NAC and NBA assessment and accreditation, and also conducted mock peer team visits. Moreover, he runs Witchcraft Publication, Media and Distribution, which is involved in content development for various programs as per UGC guidelines. He is 3-time recipient of Best Teacher Award by reputed organization. He has been recognized as the teacher leader as a selected speaker participant of the first National Teacher Congress 2016 at MIT Pune. It is indeed a privilege to have such a versatile speaker to guide us today on Criterion 2, Teaching, Learning and Evaluation. We look forward to a very enriching session. I now request Dr. Deepak Nanavre, sir, to kindly begin the session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for a wonderful and highly encouraging and motivating introduction. Good morning, one and all. Honorable Joint Director Jagtap sir, two pillars of the higher education who are setting trends and motivating teacher fraternity, Dr. Vijay Joshi sir and Dr. Pramod Pavlekar sir, Principal Dr. Rathod sir, Manjusha ma'am, and the team of Bhavans, and most important, dear colleagues, dear teacher participants. It gives me immense pleasure, first of all, to be here with you all to share some thought process on a very important issue. I must thank RUSA Maharashtra for organizing this particular faculty development program on the very serious issue, and that too giving an opportunity to deliver or have a kind of a discourse on this particular criterion, that is Criterion 2. Because all of us know that almost 35% of the weightage is being carried by single criterion, that is Criterion 2, as far as assessment and accreditation process or our SSR is concerned. But we cannot deny the fact that a lot of, say, changes have been coming up. Day before yesterday, Dr. Vani Latulkar ma'am, and yesterday, Sriharsh sir has already communicated and tried to give us the gravity that once we become aware, once we develop our seriousness and a right kind of say policies, as well as a right kind of collection of information and the processing it, rather planning to execution or implementation process and setting benchmarks at our institutional level. Well, first, this AQR process is going to certainly complementing and highly motivating or highly setting us in right direction, right tone, on right track, as far as the SSR process or assessment and accreditation process is concerned. Let me share the screen. Manjusha ma'am, is screen visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much. So, the point I was trying to mention that today, for 2 hours almost, we are going to have a dialogue and discussion as per NAC standard, and that to revise AQR format standards or whatever parameters have been set to us. We are going to discuss on the core activity or core objective of this complete system, that is one, teaching, learning, and evaluation. As far as this particular criteria is concerned, let me share some of the basics. And dear participants, just remember that you are going to have, And it has been already told by Dr. Joshi, sir, that you are going to have in end a small test, and the test would carry some of the points from my presentation also. So for all, that is UG, PG, and autonomous institutes, there are 7 key indicators in this particular criterion. Let it be SSR or let it be AQR. There are 16 metrics for UG and PG, and for autonomous, there are additionally 2 metrics added, and which comes to 18. After this overview, we need to proceed further that what exactly is the assessment criteria, or what are we going to be asked in terms of this particular criterion, because there are 7 key indicators, and in these 7 key indicators, all of you must know that first of all, we are going to be inquired or going to be asked. See, all the 7 criteria are interlinked. How? First of all, as in yesterday's criteria, we talked about the programs that we run, add-on programs and certificate programs that we run, then syllabus designing and all. Now we are into classroom. Basically, the next step or next phase is that classroom environment. So whatever students we have inducted, let it be based on gender and social diversified students and their admission mechanism. Then yesterday, Srihari sir mentioned about, very briskly about program outcome, program specific outcome, and course outcome. Not only writing, but writing, communication, and its mapping, or what you call attainment. Then further, we need to understand one of the dictum that every child is different. See, in classroom environment, we have number of students, but each and every student has got different ability or he is unique. So based on this dictum, there is an assessment parameter made. And the parameter is that whether we assess our students on the basis of their different abilities of learning. Then for different students, what type of teaching methodologies we practice? And certainly being what you call era of information and technology, how far as teachers we are techno savvy, or we take optimum benefit of technological tools and resources for strengthening or giving optimum results in the our classroom environment. And certainly this criteria also demands what about regarding the issues regarding our quality in terms of our degree experience and the assessment and evaluation in terms of understanding or getting idea that what method of assessment and evaluation do we follow, what is the frequency of evaluation, what is the purpose of our evaluation and assessment, and then how far students are satisfied with us. So let's get started, or let us get geared up to one each and every key criteria, and that too to each and every key indicator. So the first of all, there are it is told that now I believe that you know what exactly is the difference differential aspect between quantitative and qualitative, and apart from that, I won't go for that, believing that everything is clear. So 2.1 of AQR SSR deals with student enrollment and profile. Now student enrollment and profile, you can see on the screen what is to be done. We are asked student enrollment profile of the year of which we are filing AQAR. Now we need to give total number of students admitted. This is quantitative metric. And against students, number of students admitted. But before that, we'll have to go for the fact that how much was the number sanctioned by the statutory bodies or authorities. So when you fill the Excel sheet, or when you collect the data of the year, you need to go program-wise. How? First of all, name of the program. Remember, program is a degree. And course is a paper. Program is a degree. So herein after, do not get confused if I say or if I utter the word course. Course is not a degree. It is a the subject or the paper that you teach. So what is expected here? First of all, name of the program, then code of the program. Now, so many of you, people go on calling us, sir, what about program code? Those who prepare, or if we are affiliated colleges, automatically Board of Studies or the syllabus provided by the university carries program code. If not, you can at institutional level. Then number of seats sanctioned and number of students admitted. But two, make it very clear in terms of documentary aspect. Now you got the concept, but from documentary aspect, yes, you need to first of all fill in the information as per the template provided by NAC. What is it? We need to provide separate template or separate information on the basis of each and every program. Now, program wise, it means we have, suppose, for example, traditional programs, BA, all BA students, then BSc. Likewise, different programs. And simultaneously, it is the response here that how documents are generated. But till then, just remember, now every year IQAC becomes necessary that IQAC needs to collect information, or the office need to or the office need to provide information from or to IQAC, giving the details of each and every student admitted. And number of seats sanctioned, it means affiliating university needs to give that whenever we are meeting or whenever we are collecting information, we need to provide the fact, or we need to go with the fact that we need to develop our mechanism that when the admission process is being completed, automatically the data is handed over or the data is submitted to the IQAC. Now, program-wise list of the admitted student certified or signed by the principal, and at the same time, you need to collect or you need to have in your hand documents by university that the sanction strength of the particular program that you have been assigned. So two types of documents you are going to require here. One, the sanction strength, and second is not only sanction strength, but number of students you have admitted, their list, and consolidated total number of students. So this is what. After this, simple thing, this question or this metric is going to help us in this particular metric, that is 212, which is again quantitative. What is the question asked? Average percent of students or average percent of seats filled in against seat reserved for various categories. And categories have been clearly mentioned. SC, ST, OBC, Divanchan, etc. And please note, as per applicable reservation policy during the year. Okay. Now, sir, here try to understand the fact that whatever list you have program-wise of all the students admitted in your program or the programs run by the institution, now here we go, or here we proceed with the next point, that is dividing students according to different categories or reservation policies. Now we have asked, that is year-wise, number of seats embarked for reserved category as per Government of India and state government rules. For this purpose, we will need the government policy letter. IQAC will have to maintain government reservation policy letter. And according to that,
what is the standard percentage or what is the standard division you will have to mention over here. So IQAC or the sign or characteristics of or feature of functional IQAC goes for the division at the standard level. And most importantly, whatever students have been admitted, you need to divide the students on the basis of their categories. Remember, here is one line you can see given in the Excel sheet by NAC itself, that in case of minority institute, what needs to be done? In case of minority institute, we need to fill in the column others may be used and the status of the reservation for minorities specified along with supporting document. So we need to go for these filling in the data as per the specification of NAC. It means what can be done? We need to, first of all, from documentary point of view, we need to go for program-wise list of admitted students, which is certified or which is signed by the principal, which we did for 211. Then category-wise students list and consolidated number. Then government letter or letters issued by state or central government mentioning reservation policy. And here I would suggest, because on the very first day, Dr. Vijay Joshi sir also spoke out regarding the setting standards or the policy and procedures. And these benchmarks can be set. This systematization can be attained through our policy. We can have over here policy that institutional policy for admission and regarding reservation also. But that need to go in tune with the government policy. So here, after having segregation of the students into different categories, now we come directly to the classroom environment. And here we are with the 2.2, that is second key indicator mentioned, that is catering to students' diversity. I do remember few minutes before, just uttered single term that every child is different. And traditionally, we all of us know that we used to sit in classroom and just go to or have a kind of a visualization of our classroom, especially the classroom which is crowded by even my subject, English subject. If it is compulsory subject, then a gathering of 120 students. And we go on teaching to all the students in the same mode. But now, because of this qualitative metric, we need to think it differently. And we go on doing it. It doesn't mean that we have, till present day, we have not done it. But we need to do it consciously as per, and that thing or those things should be mentioned in our academic calendar and CIE also. Simultaneously, we need to understand of the fact that proper documentation is required and the frequency of those programs needs to be considered. Say, for example, as it was told yesterday and day before yesterday also, I'm not just going to give you question and answer method. Dear participant friends, we need to understand some theoretical formulations which are mandatorily to be understood for all of us. Because here, what is the concept? See, the institution assesses the learning levels of the students and organizes special programs for advanced learners and slow learners. Now, see, I have divided this particular question in two different points. First is that institution has the mechanism for assessing learning levels. And although NAC has mentioned two, that is slow and advanced, I have intentionally put one more category over there, that is moderate or average students. Let's discuss on it. And the second part of the question is, first we assess learning level, and second, we organize special programs for different levels of learners. Now, all of you know that 500 marks is the limit, sorry, 500 words is the limit for SSR, but for AQR, we have got limit of 200 words. So economy of word is most important, and that is your skill. Now, dear participant friends, here I am touching to the first point. What is that first point? The first point is assessing learning levels with multiple strategies. Now, assessing learning levels of the student, this needs to be done individually, individually by teachers. By teachers, when it is done, what has happened? At one occasion, I was told that how do they divide students according to different learning levels? They just used to go on the basis of first point that you can see on the slide or the screen. That is, they used to divide students on the basis of entry level marks. Entry level marks, is this the only criterion? No. This is a process. This is a continuous process. And that's why I would like to bring in two types of assessment modes over here. Yesterday, Srihari spoke about, say, the teacher education colleges, those who give awareness about different types of assessment and even pedagogy as well. Here, we need to understand two aspects. What are they? One is formative assessment, and other is summative assessment. Please remember this, because I am going to recreate these points when I shall be dealing with COPO map and PSO mapping. So just remember these points that we need to understand now, this particular point. So what is formative assessment and what is summative assessment? See, formative assessment is nothing else, but it goes with monitoring students' learning levels. Monitoring students' learning level. Teacher teaches something and suddenly he go on asking a kind of a check your progress level questions. Say, for example, the purpose is checking his understanding. He throws some concepts and try to get back the information or answers on the basis of the concept we discussed, and then asking students to go for quick answers. It means these are the short questions, short test, small test. It can be done in number of ways. Where teacher designs some problem set. He aims at measuring knowledge background of the student. Then he try to measure his comprehension, application, and evaluation ability of the particular subject on the basis of the teacher, on the basis of the topic taught. It means when we try to divide our students or say assess learning level of the student, we need to take care that we go for even diagnostic test. This can be a continuous or within a month or two, we can go for that. How? First of all, entry marks, take help of it, entry marks, but simultaneously, you can divide your Excel sheet or tabular form that in front of every student, a student's name, put entry level mark, and simultaneously, we go for the classroom participation, application ability, test participation, or you can have the knowledge related activity, and teachers know how we can judge the base of the student, whether he is good in the subject or not. One student who is very good or excellent or excelling in some subject may not be good in other subject. Okay, so here, first of all, we need to understand that assessing learning level is not one step process. It is the multiple step process. I uttered the word that is the diagnostic test and class test. And on the basis of it, you try to go for check his knowledge, comprehension, application, and you go for evaluation capacity. So you can have better, you can have our institutional policy, which will give uniformity of institutional level. What do we try to check? I have shown a heart, brain, and hands. And on the basis of it, I would like to go to the fundamentals of knowledge process or holistic development of the students that we go for. What you call cognitive, which is based on, and this is the core thing or core aspect that we touch upon. Secondly, we even help students to develop his attitude, that is affective approach of it. And simultaneously, psychomotor approach, we go what you call with the developing physical skill of the student. Students in Hindi, I just call it as dil, dimag, or heart. Dil, dimag, or heart. So better if we focus on cognitive approach, we get some of the basic idea that what are the characteristics that are being displayed by slow learner. Every slow learner, it deals with attention plan, concentration plan, reaction time, limited self-direction, and lack of ability of abstraction, then association, and simultaneously even goal setting also, or not able to do with mental processes. If we divide our students into slow and advanced learners, simultaneously, it is important that what institution, and this is the second part, what institution does for the slow learner. Slow learners can be benefited by one, compensatory teaching. What is that compensatory teaching? That with the help of even activities, pictorial method, film, or giving examples of live experiences can help him to cope up, at least understand the concept to the minimum level. Or there is a common concept that we use, that is remedial teaching. But remember, documentation is very important. That how many students you had selected for remedial, then their timetable, topic discussed, signatures of the students, and then what was the feedback, then what type of study material. You can give study material, additional study material. You can use different activities. Then you can provide additional resources, and you can have, say, practice tests, additional practice tests, and even guided sessions also. So basically, you go for any activity. What is our purpose? Those who are lacking in the subject, they should be at least able to come to the minimum acceptable level. Now, in terms of advanced learners, we go for checking his cognitive skills, and cognitive skills show us that whoever is advanced learner, he has got keen power of objection. He is always interested, enthusiastic. He has got good basic knowledge. And then he has got interest in problem solving in the subject, applying concepts, then intellectual curiosity and critical thinking power level. And here I would like to take, later on, I'm going to refer to Bloom's taxonomy, which again yesterday, Srihari sir has shown you the diagram, but lower order and higher order. Usually, with advanced learner, we go with the higher order of Bloom's taxonomy. So better, we need to mention what institution does. And at right side, you can see that institution or the teacher can go for allowing choice of learning to advanced students. Allowing choice, it means what? It means apart from lectures, teacher can give additional work or some kind of, say, project or concept or case study or higher order questions to these advanced learners. And simultaneously, he can help him, he can be helped in terms of integration of technology, group activities working together, then simultaneously accommodating pace of his learning, then after determining prior knowledge, we can lead him to the creative aspect and independent learning project and encouraging self-assessment. Say, for example, even I would like to refer to Avishkar. Which students do we select for Avishkar Research Festival? Naturally, when there is a notice in a staff room that we receive, automatically we have some students in mind. It means we help them, or we try to adjust them, or we try to take them with us in terms of higher order or research aspect of thinking. So independent survey, analytical aspects, and higher order aspects can be dealt in terms of the dealing with the advanced learner. But remember, once again, I'm pointing out that you will have to have the proper record of it, proper record, and how the students were benefited. Now let us come to the next, that is catering to student diversity. But the metric 2:2:2 is student full-time teacher ratio. Now, student full-time teacher ratio, here I know that some of the questions were asked previously also, and I'm going to answer those questions. So total number of students enrolled, simply speaking, against the total number of full-time teachers. Now, NAC has already made it clear who is a full-time teacher. A teacher employed at least 90% of the normal or statutory number of hours of work for a full-time teacher over a complete academic year is classified by full-time teacher. So means full-time appointment is given and the workload is minimum 90% of the workload is given to the teacher is qualified to be called as the full-time teacher. Now question rises whether what about the appointment made by the management, those who are full-time, but appointment made by the management. They can be appointment sanctioned post or appointment management appointed post also workable. No part-time, no ad hoc, no visiting faculty. Now, whenever you are going to plan for filing AQR, first of all, from office, you will have to collect the list of the teachers. That day there was a question that can librarian be a full-time teacher? To be specific, to be clear, that day we gave the answer that mode of the appointment. But simple thing that we are governed by the Act. We are governed by the Act. And in Act, the cash benefits are given to librarian in terms of as other teachers are given. So there is no harm that you add librarian in the list of full-time teacher. Okay, so remember that that day I told that some queries had come, but if query is asked, we can defend that query that being a full-timer, he is eligible to all the cash promotions. Likewise, the teachers, other teachers get the benefit of cash under teacher category. Now, 2-3-1, we are moving on to the next key indicator, that is 2-3-1. The metric is qualitative metric. Student-centric methods such as experiential learning, participative learning, problem-solving methodologies are used for enhancing learning experience. Before I start anything with this, I would like to just mention how the concept of teacher has changed these days. During our old days, teacher was the sole dictator. He was at the center of the class and he was the only one who was allowed to speak. But now there is a concept which is called as teacher is a guide by side, not at the center. Teacher is a guide by side. Going with this theory or this framework, NAC has expected from us that we practice different pedagogic methods, different teaching methods over here. Now, what is it? NAC has specifically mentioned, which I enlisted in the corner of my slide, that is experiential learning, participative learning, and problem solving. I'm talking about AQR, but as far as SSR is concerned, remember, this question is highly scoring question, and this question or this metric has got large number of marks. It is approximately, 30, it goes to even 30 marks. So now, before that, we'll have to go for the basics of what exactly is the participative learning. That is, Latuka ma'am pointed out some aspect. But first of all, if we talk of experiential learning, what you call the learning through experience. Whatever activity, or through any activity, you give students learning experience simultaneously, that activity is learning through, or the experiential learning is learning through reflections on doing. Actually, student participates in the role, and whatever experiences he gets, he marks it out. And that's why experiential learning involves individual learning process. So I have shown you some of the examples over here, like say field work, mock parliament, role play, and even the visiting to the zoo, real life experience being taken by the students. So what does what is included in this. There can be field work, there can be on-job training, simultaneously role play, community-based learning, industrial visits, mock parliament, socio-economic surveys, then simulations, and on-job training also. So I would like to just recreate that internship, training, training. There can be a concept of summer school also. And what is the purpose? What do we do here? Through internship, training, and summer school, we try to bridge the gap between industry and academia. And we can even help them to motivate for the research. I would like to quote here that even there are some virtual learning activities those can be done. I would like to refer to MHRDC and even Amruta University. They have they can have collaboration with colleges. If you apply in a proper order, they can have they can have even virtual sessions which will be giving you experiential learning, say practice of methodology. So, but very importantly, you need to remember that whatever your activity, we conduct so many activities, but we fail in documentation. Say, for example, if you are taking students to fieldwork, first of all, prepare plan, it is sanctioned, it must be mentioned in your academic calendar, what is the purpose of fieldwork, what are your objectives behind that activity, number of students participated, how many days it was scheduled, then geotag photograph as your habit now, because mandatorily it is being asked, then the student signatures, their feedbacks, then if it is a field work, the project submitted and their feedback and outcome, what have you attained? You can make the activity and finally activity report submitted to the institution or higher authority. So it means every activity you need to carry the simultaneous or parallel documentation process. If we come to the next part, what is that? Participative learning. It is a kind of a peer teaching. It is kind of activity learning based on group work and cooperative and collaborative learning principles. Now, we can have creative brainstorming sessions, community participation, fieldwork, and demonstration. Like say, we can help our students to organize seminars, group activities based on curriculum, then simultaneously different types of models and charts. Which is visualized, and these are some of the photographs that I have taken from some of the colleges' website. And when we move on to the next concept, that is problem-solving method, remember two things: that is a real-life case study or real-life situation, real-life problem, project, research project can be given to the students following different types of or proper methodologies of problem-solving. That we need to give them idea of problem identification, analysis, development, implementation, and evaluation. And we know that the story, intentionally this story I have added over that, this analytical brainstorming or critical approach, if we help students to develop in them, automatically we will go on, say, developing students in higher order of the presentation. This is in nutshell the activities that can be conducted. Say here, here we can have experiential learning. These are some of the minimum I'm just posing, that what can be done in participative learning, what can be done in problem solving method. And intentionally I have put this ICT enabled learning, that is smart class, NPTEL, language lab, and different say platforms. Now, on the first day, I don't want to forget that question and which I had promised to you, because these days we have been engaging students online, and how these different teaching methodologies or pedagogies can be practiced. One, we have in classroom, we have real life or real environment, but now, or what you call real learning environment. Now, time has asked us or compelled us to go for virtual learning environment creation. I repeat, virtual environment creation in our virtual class. So when we are engaging class online, instead of just doing it one side activity, one thing, although you are delivering lecture, simultaneously you can, we have chat box over there. In chat box, we can throw concept, strong concept. For example, whatever points do we teach, or preliminary or base knowledge would like to share. Well, you can throw those questions and immediately you can have those answers in chat box. So it means automatically students come out with, they are engaged in the activity. Simultaneously, if at all we have given some example or the some concept, and if we ask them, what other concepts do you find? Simultaneously, they try to participate. And even virtually, you can divide students into different groups and you can give online projects. And they can submit online, and this can be done through collaborative activity, video, audio visual tools, and simultaneously activity based dialogue boxes, one of the concepts. And these can be submitted online. But for this, you need to use platform of learning management system, that is LMS. Through LMS, LMS, you have limited group. Say, for example, even Google Class, you can start with. We have been doing it for, suppose, for example, we are conducting workshop, and even with the students also, we have conducting workshop. We go for Google Class and we go on asking them to submit their projects, group projects to us through electronic mode. So the point I'm trying to mention is that yes, certainly there are going to be limitations, but due to demand of the time, we will have to cope up or adjust with the higher or different types of experimentation in terms of technology. Say, for example, even quiz also can be done, and number of issues can be done. Due to time constraints and the length of this criteria, I'm rather moving further to 2.3, teaching learning process. Teaching learning process 232 is qualitative. The teacher use ICT-enabled tools, including online resources for autonomous institute, because the questions are same, but for autonomous institute, there is additional, words over there, that is including online resources for autonomous institute, it is written for effective teaching learning process. So what can be the teaching learning tools? One, as I mentioned, learning management system. It can be free, as freely available. Majority of you might be conducting, because COVID has taught us this new know-how, how, and practical know-how that too. It can be customized using Moodle. It can be free, that is Google Class, which I mentioned. Any online meeting platform, that now also we have a meeting online meeting platform. Simultaneously, Moodle customized platform, then YouTube, internet-supported learning, virtual laboratory, in FlipNet sources, then OESR, Open Educational Resources, you can go for. You can, teachers can start their blogs, and they can have, circulate even recorded lectures, and they can even promote students, and they can develop their own books. So all these tools that can be used, whatever is used for preparing your digital resource, it can be inducted in digital tool or communicate electronically for the purpose of teaching learning. So now, what is important, that most of the teachers go on asking us what documentary support you need to. IQAC coordinators, please remember, every year, make it a habit or make it a routine that whatever resource has been generated or whatever tools, some tools might be purchased by the college. And if it is purchased by the college, Kangode sir will mention how bill is important, how its entry in debt stock register is important, name of the vendor is important, and then again, it goes to even audited statements also. But till then, just remember, I don't want to touch, because in fourth criterion, whatever college claims that these are the ICT resources we have, geotagged photograph and bills are being demanded. But till then, I just restrict over here myself that these tools, teacher-wise, we need to enlist tools, and we need to give proof. So I would suggest concept of dynamic website over here. Concept of dynamic, link your LMS to the, as in the form of one of the tabs at your institutional, on your institutional website. Secondly, whatever resources your teacher has generated, even those resources can be say uploaded or can given the link on the institutional website and whatever open ended. But just remember, whatever is there, it needs to be, if you have taken some open educational resource, why without a breach of agreement or anything, a copyright issue, you can use them. So first check, and then you need to enlist, and simultaneously you are requested for its link. So if at all you link it to institutional website, it becomes highly useful for you to give link, and it is authenticated. But remember, if you have saved it on your Google Drive and you are providing link to NAT, no Google Drive or third-party storage platform is accepted. Okay. So here, again, one more aspect that is popping in the form of teaching learning process, that is ratio of mentor to students for academic and other related issues. Now, what is mentoring? Please, my request is, do not get confused between mentoring and counseling. Counselor is a trained or certified person to deal with the specific or individual case related to with the help of through the graduate. Here we are mentor, that is Vidyarthi Shikshak Palak. Some colleges have named it. Now, first of all, I would suggest to go for mentoring policy here also, that what are you going to mentor? Academic related issues. So you need to develop or design forms, how mentor are going to say have a sitting. In terms of AQR, the data is requested in terms of what? Number of full-time teachers and number of mentors appointed, number of mentors and number of mentees allotted. So what the documentary proofs are required? One, the notices by the principal. You need to have mentoring committee, because mentoring committee is responsible for monitoring the process. Okay, so you need to have every year notices pertaining to the details of mentor and their allotted mentee. Then approved mentor list, means teacher-wise or mentor-wise mentee list. Then record of the issues raised and resolved by the mentor. This, for example, individually you will have to go for the form. How the form can be, let me share that. Name of the college, then everything, mentoring scheme, academic year, name of the student, roll number. Okay. But apart from that, you can have his small SWOT analysis, strength, weaknesses, and then his areas, hobbies, whether he has taken some health similar previous before joining college or anywhere, who was previous mentor. Then you can list out some areas related to academic. See, simple questions are very simple. Like say, I'm not able to concentrate. I'm not able to remember. I have certain problem with this. I have fear for mathematics. Like say, any issue. And remember, first year student is going to ask different questions. And third year student is going to ask different questions because they are outgoing. They are on the verge of outgoing. So naturally, they may ask for goal setting, then appearing for different examinations, then what to do next, higher education progression. So these are the issues that can be asked, and you will have to maintain those fielding cases. And the mentoring committee needs to monitor as per the convenience or as per the policy of the institution, and what is the final payout. At the end of the year, what is the change or what are the outcomes of it? So activity report, likewise activity report, mentoring report may be submitted. But remember, AQR also will demand your format, filled in cases. Additionally, you can complement it with the policy for mentoring at institutional level. So basically, mentoring is a kind of a semi-structured guidance related to sharing knowledge, experience, assist, help, training, motivation, advice, support, and setting up goal, coaching, and direction. I hope things are clear. Previously, this was qualitative metric, but now this is quantitative. I would like to go to one more metric that is only given in the manual of autonomous. This metric is not for UG or PG institutes. what is it? Preparation and adherence to academic calendar and teaching plan by the institution. So this qualitative metric was discussed yesterday extensively, that how it is important that we need to have correct or exact idea of academic calendar, which will also include your continuous internal evaluation, how it needs to be prepared, your coordinating our team, suggestions received by different stakeholders, different departments and sections, then teaching and activity plan, then committee-wise activity. But remember that it was also told that the adherence to academic calendar also needs to be monitored by IQAC, because IQAC's role has been highly strengthened role, because it is responsible for setting benchmark and for procedures for institutionalization of quality initiatives. And that's why IQAC need to follow up and measure compliance as per planning and maintenance records. So I need not go for the repetition that yesterday it was discussed. Just I wanted to show or just give the idea that this particular aspect is also there touched upon. So 2.4, when we come to 2.41 and 2.43, I have taken intentionally together, because the data template is the same for 2.41, 2.43. And remember, additionally, this particular template is also going to be used for verification of information where we were demanded full-time teachers, like say, full-time teachers on roll, and simultaneously full-time teachers, student teacher ratio, as well as mentoring. Okay, 2-2-3 and 2-2-3. It means this particular data template is useful for four metrics. And that's why I have taken these particular questions together, that average percentage of full-time teachers against sanctioned post during the year. Already I have mentioned that they can be government approved full-time teachers, or they can be management approved full-time teachers. No, NAC has clearly mentioned that they can also be management approved teachers. So average percentage of full-time teachers against sanctioned post. And second is 2.43 is number of years of teaching experience of full-time teachers in the same institution. Now, so remember, while visiting different colleges, we realize that the appointment letters are issued by the institute, but teacher have mentioned their experience since inception of their service. No, it has clearly mentioned that the teaching experience in the same institution, this must be taken care of. So what is being required? First of all, name of the teacher. As a documentary proof, you need to have PAN card, because PAN number is demanded. Then his designation, in which year was he appointed, nature of appointment, whether against a sanctioned post, temporary or permanent. You see, permanent, temporary teacher can be maybe given full-time appointment. It doesn't mean that every time he's given a permanent appointment, if he is only full-time teacher, no. So it is internal part of administration, the name of the department and experience in the same institution, and whether or is the teacher still in service. Dear teacher, here, and dear IQAC coordinator, just remember that we need to, first of all, enlist the name of the teacher, his designation, and the department, first of all, and then, we go for what kind of documents? Appointment orders of the teachers, and simultaneously PAN cards. Okay, so these two paper documentary proofs, and simultaneously sanction post later by the government. So because and that particular paper is going to help us. The letter is going to help us to prove or to accept the claim, or to prove our claim that these were the sanctioned posts with us by the government. Now, whenever you provide documents, remember, you have 2-3 different tabs. One, if it is quantitative metric, you have to fill in the data in number in the data template. But when there are two tabs, one, additional information, and the documents related to it. you need to divide, you need to scan them in a proper order, arrange them chronologically, and whenever you are scanning them, before that, make it a point that it is certified by the principal and if possible IPSC coordinator. And wherever, whatever document you are going to provide, make it a point that if from the document title, from the document title, if the title is not, we understand, or any reader understand that what the document is about, no problem. If not, you highlight whatever is required or just put what are you mentioning over there. At one college I had visited, and where I found that they have taken walk-ins of students in the library. Walk-ins of the students, signature were taken, signature, roll number and signatures were there. But whatever pages were scanned, I didn't see serial number was written or name of the college. At least stamp would have been put. Just I asked, whose papers are these? They said, these papers belong to library and we have taken, we have scanned and taken Xerox of the register. But that the paper, or those papers, those were scanned, did not carry name of the institute, neither date, name of the institution, nor certified by anyone that how many numbers of the students visited the library or daily walk-ins of the library. So when you prepare document, see that characteristically document needs to be complete. What you call WH of document. What is the document? What is the purpose of creating document? Who is creating document? And what needs to be given in the document? So try to understand the fact that simply without getting burdened, because this particular process, I believe, has done very simple, very user-friendly, and very transparent. While we begin with the process at initial stage, we think that it is burden. Nak is something like, let's say, breeding animal. No. We need to design and develop our system to the level that it, whatever we claim, it must be proved as authentic. Because all of you know that all the quantitative metrics are being evaluated, examined by whom? By third party partner, DBB partners. And if we provide documentary support in a proper manner, automatically, even our DVV also becomes very easy for us. Okay, so hereinafter, let us move on to the next, that is 242, which is quantitative. Now, this is for PG and autonomous. You may ask me, does it mean that 242 is not for UG? It is for UG, the same question, but some columns are not for UG. So I have separated it. Okay. So the point I'm trying to mention is that in 242, in quantitative metric, we are asked average percentage of full-time teachers with PhD. And these degrees have been mentioned during last 5 years. But here, remember, this particular year we need to mention. And we need to consider highest degree count. And this particular metric is going to be useful for us for other metrics from third criterion. What are they? 312 and 331. Okay, in terms of research. Now, what does the Excel sheet demand? First of all, list of the teachers, full-time teachers, name of the full-time teachers with PhD in everything. Put list of the teacher year-wise, then qualifications. If they are same, don't worry. You add all the teachers. Put teacher's highest qualification and year. Although teacher has not acquired that particular degree during the year of which you are filing AQR, no problem. You put the year. Here you are asked that whether that teacher is recognized guide. Then it means you can get the sense and smell of the document. First of all, the name of the teacher, if it the list, appointment letters, which you have already procured. Qualification means highest qualification letter you should have of each and every teacher. Then simultaneously, if the teacher is recognized as PhD guide recognition letter. Now, year of recognition letter is mentioned over there. Teacher serving in the institute, yes or no, can be written. Then name of the scholar under whom, who are working under that particular teacher, year of registration and thesis. It means year of registration and title of thesis. Say, for example, here you need all the registration letters of the students, those who are working under the teacher. It means, but natural, whatever point has been asked, we need to have documentary proof. So IQACs, please remember, to avoid 11th hour or last hour hurry and scurry for collection of what you call the documents. Sometimes teacher may leave, teacher may get retired. And as it was said by Joshi sir, that instead of making it a fifth year celebration or fifth year ceremony, let it make it a day, everyday ceremony or everyday routine or what you call policy. So preparing a policy or frequency of collection of documents is what you call institutional understanding. I told you that for UG, only four columns are there. What they are asked about: name of full-time teacher, highest qualification and its year, then full-time teacher with so-and-so degrees, and here the teachers, whether teacher is serving in the institution. Documents already I have given to you. Let us proceed further to 2.251. And what is it? Now, from teaching learning to, we are coming to evaluation process. And evaluation process, in terms on the screen, you can see, what is it? It is qualitative metric, that mechanism of internal assessment is transparent and robust in terms of frequency and mode. So remember that mechanism of assessment, and remember that this is nothing else but for what you call UG and PG. This metric is not for autonomous. In this key indicator, you will find more different questions for autonomous institute than UG and PG. Now, here, when we talk in terms of answering this particular question, one that is strong and transparent, and other aspect that is robust, which means strong and healthy. Now, we have internal assessment for what? Remember, what I have observed is internal assessment we go for, suppose if it is 50 marks paper, for 50 marks assessment done by the university in terms of the semester-based examination in CBCS, we just remember 10 marks internal examination, or if it is 130 or 50, like 70-30 or 80-20 pattern. It doesn't mean that we don't have any other assessment mode. Here, I would like to just pass on the message. Remember that you have developed your continuous internal evaluation. Now, in terms of continuous internal evaluation, I told you that it can be divided in formative assessment and summative assessment. Summative at the year end, whose marks are entered in the mark list. But does it mean that only to give a lot marks in the mark list, assessments are being conducted? No. In the formative assessment, we use it for whom? For assessing students' learning levels. It means dividing students into learning level one. And secondly, we need to go for the mapping of course outcome, course objectives, and course outcomes. And even course outcomes, program outcomes, and program specific outcomes. Because programs with this mapping of CO, PO, and PSO has to do with your internal assessment schedule, your internal assessment methodologies. Dear participant friends, you may get confused when we will be discussing mapping, but there, here itself, I'm preparing some ground that we need to understand that internal assessment can be a formative and on continuous basis in addition to summative. So just to conclude this particular part, that internal assessment can be used for assessment of or checking the course and program and program specific outcomes. Secondly, it can be used for dividing students into different levels of learning. So here, what document is required? One, that is planning of examination and evaluation, what you call CIE in academic calendar. Then modes of internal assessment. That's what I also told you. Then apart from that, you want actual internal assessment implementation and its record explaining transparency and robustness. And what can be internal assessment mechanism is you have designed your schedule, or assessment can be say internal test, regular internal test. It can be term end, it can be assignment, it can be oral, tutorial, seminar, class test, project, surveys. Apart from that, you have policy that those students who have participated in sports or other activities, they need to reappear. You give special provision, and simultaneously you go for even giving notices. You go on giving notices to whom? Notices to students in well in advance, their schedules. Schedules. If somebody is absent, then absentee report. Then assessment period is given. Results are declared. If a student comes out with a complaint, change in name, correction in name, then marks, absentee mark, then help for scribe. So many issues are there. The result is not declared. So whatever is in your hand, you go for that. But whatever you help a student, it needs to be documented. That student comes orally, or if he has given application at many places, what we have observed is that it is not documented. Register entries are not maintained. So if you maintain that, the same example or same document you can provide. Say, for example, if it is the grievance related to university, through your channel, a student is getting benefited. It is your policy of what internal and the assessment also, whatever you have done. So better I would suggest that here examination committee and simultaneously institutional policy for mechanism of internal assessment and the purpose of it. So dear participant, here we come to the autonomous metric 2.5.1. It is quantitative. Number of days from the date of last semester. This is not for UG at UG or PG. UG or PG. So number of days from the date of last semester end, year or year end examination till the declaration of results. So here, Autonomous Institute needs to provide the data in terms of name of the program, its code, semester, and then last date of semester end and year end examination, and then the date of declaration of the result. So you will have to procure the document of your academic plan approved by the your institution, then closing opening dates and everything, and you will have to fill in the data. Next, now 2.5.2 qualitative metric is related to mechanism to deal with internal and external examination related grievances, is transparent, time bound and efficient. And here again I would like to go back, its relation to which question, that this 2.5.1, here most of the things I have mentioned are from 2.5.2, because here until and unless you go for policy of transparency and robustness, no further things can be practiced in terms of the handling grievances. Grievances, already I have explained grievances to you, that these grievances are in terms of the very small things, that change in name, subject change, non-receipt of the hall ticket, and then declaration of result, then fail, absent, then wrong marks or revaluation, whatever is there. internal examination conducted by you and simultaneously university related. So my suggestion would be, in this area we have observed that many places at college level, whenever students' grievances are solved, those papers are not maintained or they are neglected to be maintained. So better you can have entry, and here you can have your own audit that particular exam. Grievance redressal committee can prepare a small policy that how far and what would be the time limit, whatever the cases are in hand, and what would be the student support, because this particular question is going to be again linked to even criterion 5, that how students are being benefited or given help, given support. So the point I was trying to mention, first of all, institutional examination grievance related policy can be made. This policy can be revised time and again. Then communication of a policy to stakeholder. Then setting practicing procedural matters and documents. Then a grievance redressal committee and its detail. Nature of grievance, you can have sample cases. You can provide some sample cases. And suppose you have not been able to solve. This goes with what you call ISO standard, that where you have your own system, but in all processes, whatever errors you found, pitfalls you found, you can go for corrective measures, and those so that they must not be repeated in future, and not to repeat, we go for corrective measures. So with this, we can have for autonomous, we can have discussion on the metric that is allotted for autonomous colleges, 252, because previous one was for UG and PG. The same 252 is different for, and this is quantitative, number of students complaints or grievances against evaluation against the total number who appeared in the examination during the year. Mode of the base of the question is same, but here clearly the number of complaints or grievances have been asked. So you need to maintain that register, as I told you, that you need to upload the number of complaints and total number of students who appear for the examination, that total number of students, number of cases, and its proof. Okay. So, and you can add as additional information, you can upload policy also. Now, for autonomous only, for UG and PG, we don't have 253, but only for autonomous, there is one more metric, because already I have told you, for UG and PG, there are 16 metrics, and for PG, for autonomous, there are 18 metrics. So this is one additional quantitative IT integration and reforms in the examination process, and processes including continuous internal assessment have brought in considerable improvement in the examination management systems of the institution. So what you need to give? You need to give, first of all, examination, you have CIA, you have examination calendar, you have CIA, but here integration of IT, that what are all IT resources? And if it is purchased, again, this will be clarified in criterion 4, that if institution has purchased its screenshots, then its bills, its entry into dead stock registers, then actually its utilization, as I told you, that the screenshots, and simultaneously how these things have been helping or used and practiced on, what is the objective? It means IT tool, examination evaluation process, frequency, what are the ICT tools you have been using, how they are consolidated, overall means starting from examination plan notice to setting question papers, declaration of results, generating mark list. So all these things are needed, including grievance, how technologically or what type of management you have been prepared. And this is again going to be linked with the next, that is one of the metrics from sixth criterion, where you have MIS, some part is going to be linked. And here we come to the very core or very, very, very important question. Program and course outcomes for all programs offered by the institution, and our institution are stated and displayed on website and communicated to teachers and students. So here, first of all, try to understand what are learning outcomes. Learning outcomes is nothing else. Yesterday, Srihari sir has pointed out it very briefly and clearly. The same thing I'm going to tell you, that what students are expected to be able to do upon the successful completion of the program or course. Means we teach paper. After teaching that particular paper, what students are going to learn. So whenever there is a need, why I would like to stress on this particular aspect more or to at length, because we have gone through so many course outcomes, program outcomes, and program specific outcome written, but they need to be revised in terms of theoretical formulation suggested by some expert in the area. I would like to mention what is the outcome. I would like to show one of the pictures. You can see a car. Okay, a new brand car is handed. A key of new brand car is handed over to whom? Handed over to the driver. Suppose he is handed key and he drives. What are the possibilities? Possibility is that if he doesn't know how to drive properly, or if he is not licensed driver or trained driver, he may meet an accident. As you see, somebody is lying on the bed in the hospital. If not, he may break new brand car, disturbing or creating lot of nuisance. But if he is properly trained driver, the end result would be successful reaching to the destination. And this was expected outcome before driving car. With this simple example, I would like to show the similar picture over here to you, that it is said that every beginning has an end, so does the education. Now, we help many students, thousands of students every year, but how do we see our students at the age of graduation? It is graduated, one possibility, list of unemployment, or with some kind of skill. This is a skills development, there is a lot of buzz. He can be a chaiwala, and or he can be a technocrat earning highest. So how do you project your students after completion of his or her graduation? And that's why I just would like to go back to the fact that writing CO, they are interlinked. How? Yesterday, Srihari sir rightly pointed out, say, for example, course, as I told you, that one that we teach in the class, that is paper, for example, BA History. BA History has got BA Civilization. We have program outcome. We have program like degree that I told you, BA, BCom, BSc, BBA, so and so. Okay. But as far as yesterday, he also spoke out that clearly BSc Chemistry. Okay, that is program in within BSc, what kind of special knowledge. So what is being suggested, that these courses, course paper, means after studying, after teaching paper, that particular paper, here I would like to mention, first of all, that see, we have lesson outcome, whatever lesson we teach, we should aim or project what is going to be learned by the student, or what students are going to be achieved at the end when class lesson is discussed. Then course is a paper. After studying this course, what student is going to study? Program outcome, after completion of this program, degree, what student is going to get? And then degree level outcome, or specific, what you call, we will call it as the program specific. Now, I would like to take you to the plan that when we think of course, technically it is suggested that every paper we go for 4 to 6 COs. And when we observe, we realize that they are not chronologically arranged, because Earlier it was mentioned that we go from lower order to higher order. How? I will show you an example of Bloom's taxonomy. Yesterday it was displayed. Say, for example, first three, what are they? One is remember, second is understand, third is apply, analyze, evaluate, and level six is create. First three are known to be lower order thinking matter. And now you can imagine what type of question papers we take. Do we touch, or how far, or to what extent we touch when we prepare or when we design question papers, how many questions we design in terms of creating, evaluation, and analyzing. So the objective needs of our outcome, expected outcome, needs to be designed with the help of these points. That is, some objectives related to remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing. Say, for example, I would like to mention nowhere to go. If you Google this concept, active work of Bloom's taxonomy, I repeat, active works of Bloom's taxonomy, you will find that under every category, a list is given. Like say, remember, demonstrate, recall, enlist, based on remembering. Then understanding, question based on understanding. Some active words are given. And that's what I would like to mention, that whenever you are creating, whenever you are preparing COs, take help of Bloom's taxonomy, and with the help of Bloom's taxonomy, see the strength of your syllabus, and try, you can visualize to what extent of the education you would like to take your student after studying that particular course. Sometimes it is observed that those who have written COs, they start with creation level. Means first point itself, creation level. Apply, direct application. So we need to go chronologically with the help of active work. I repeat, active words. And why this has become important? That when we write COs, we have some kind of, say, set goal, that this is what we are going to achieve. Now we have written and communicated. Nat asked whether you have written. Yes, written. For all papers we have written. They are communicated. When can we communicate? During induction program, through LMS. And then they are uploaded on our website. Our task is over. But this task, does it get over to this point only? No. If you will have to refer to writing POs and PSO to whom? To this particular slide, that is UGC's notification circular on August 18, and again it is revised in 19 also. It is available on website. It is called as a learning outcome based curriculum framework. In short, it is called as LOCF. Dear participant teachers, if you have not yet gone through this circular, if you have not downloaded or designed the COs, POs and PSOs referring to this, my request, humble request. Because why? Because UGC has made it clear that the quality of teaching is judged by the quality of learning that takes place in the class. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, you are.
Yes, sir.
But your screen is not visible, sir.
I shall. Suddenly I got dropped. But till yes. The last point, I hope it was clear.
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay, ma'am. Within a minute, I shall share. Within a minute, ma'am.
Yes, it's no problem.
Yes, sir. Sure.
Yes, ma'am. I think the screen is visible now.
Screen is
yes,
visible. Sir. Now go to your relevant
yes,
slide,
yes.
please.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, I was here. I was telling, I was trying to just recall the point or the statement made by UGC that teaching is just, quality of teaching is judged by quality of learning. So what UGC has made clear that whether education should give employment or employability, assure employability, not just employ, but creating or generating employability skills. And that's why LOCF has made it clear that make student an active learner, good facilitator, by in order to lay the foundation of lifelong learning. And with this gravity, just I would like to move on to the one of the aspects of this particular thing, that is when we write the COs, PEOs, and PSOs, we need to take first of all help of Bloom's taxonomy. Secondly, UGC in LOCF has given graduate attributes. What did I say? Graduate attributes. I have enlisted some of the graduate attributes that at the end of your graduation, how do you or what do you see in your student? That is, you start from disciplinary knowledge, communication skills, critical, problem, analytical, research related, cooperation, scientific, reflective, information literacy as well as digital literacy, then self-directed learning, multicultural competence, moral and ethical awareness, leadership, and simultaneously lifelong learning. So how far or how many points from here we can connect our students to? So LOCF mentions of graduate attributes, and simultaneously LOCF also mentions qualification descriptors. So in number, I would just like to mention that 4 to 6 is ideal number for CO. For PO, 8 to 12, because NBA, National Board of Accreditation, has given list of 12 program outcomes, and simultaneously 3 to 5 program specific outcomes. You need to write. So just to answer this particular question, you write the first part, you will get marks. But when you come to the next question, that is 15 marks question in SSR, COPO mapping and attainment, how you go for this? Now, NAC has not suggested any standard method as NBA has suggested. If you log on, if you log in to internet or Google it, you will find that there is a standard procedure suggested by NBA, which is practiced by all the institutions, those who are accredited or those who are connected to AICT. But one day we are waiting when that particular type of system or any other system is being suggested by NAC. Now attainment check. The question is just related to attainment. That COPO attainment check. Now many colleges are going for attainment with the help of COPO, PSO writing and just linking the activities or the test or assessment done in terms of attainment or fulfillment of those attainments. I repeat, test, activities or assessment or any activity organized in or with the objective of that particular CO or PO or PSO. So this attainment is written, but remember in standard situation, this may sound, because I'm rather fearing whether some of you may get confused. Now, first of all, what is the standard procedure suggest for COPO mapping? First of all, we write COs, and COs, POs, and PSOs. Then After writing CO, PO, PSO, we go for correlation. Of my particular paper, CO1 correlates to which point from PO and which point from PSO. It means we go for correlation. Likewise, COPO correlation. Actually, frankly speaking, in many institutes, we have conducted COPO writing and COPO mapping workshop, and that has taken itself every day 3 to 5 hours. So this is rather the concept that required a lot of practice and a lot of understanding and deliberations. So briefly, I'm telling you, so correlations are written. Where do they match? Then teaching plans are prepared and assessment plans are prepared. With assessment plans, rubrics are prepared. I don't want to make things difficult, but once I shall try to show you some of the slides, things will get clear to you. Then our assessment plan starts with, in terms of implementation, setting question papers as per assessment plan. Now, COPO and PSO mapping COPO PSOs are mapped through our question paper and assessment plan. Just remember, an assessment plan as well as our course end survey, program exit survey. It means we will have to design mapping policy. Now, how do we start with? First of all, we have our CIE, which is discussed earlier. We have assessment plan. How assessment plan? I will explain. For example, I have a 50 marks paper. I have to be discussed in that particular semester. What do I do is, I am known as a course coordinator. Teacher is identified by different concept, different title, that is course coordinator by NBE. So this course coordinator decides how many tests or what type of test. It can be assignment, it can be class test, it can be internal, and how many tests. How many tests or presentation, and what would be the marks? What would be the marks given, maximum marks? So suppose in a test, then I'm going to conduct a course exit survey also, and then university assessment also. So this will include in the complete evaluation pattern of my semester related to this particular paper. Now, suppose there is a class test. When I prepare question paper, every question paper I mark to which CO it is being mapped. Which CO it is being mapped. Suppose if it is objective question, the question is of 1 mark. So 1 mark question, it means CO1 is carrying 1 mark. Nowhere it is carrying 1 mark. This is the target that I have kept. But simultaneously, what I will go do is, suppose 60 students have appeared for examination, I will count their marks and I will take average of it. Suppose if it comes 0.89, it means target was 1 for that particular question, but what is attainment? 0.89. So here, everywhere COs are mapped. Say for example, I will show you this slide. What is it? See, COs are written. I have suggested ideally you may go even to up to 5, 6. POs are written, 11 POs are written. For example, now I have to match where my CO1 is getting correlated, and I do it. How do I do it? I do it. See, I think my first CO is getting matched or getting correlated with PO2. So what is the level? Now I decide strength also. What is the strength? Weak, medium, and strong. Weak is 1, medium is 2, and strong is 3. And wherever there is nothing written, there is no correlation at all. So wherever, and what is logic behind it? As a teacher, as a subject coordinator, or what you call course coordinator, I write the justification of it. So here I have shown you some example that medium level 3, COPO correlation, and strong 2. After that, what are my assessment level? Again, Bloom's taxonomy comes in. Bloom's taxonomy, see, these are the 6 levels of Bloom. Then I have prepared my rubric that I am going to analyze and evaluate these four standards based on regular internal test, term end, assignments, oral, tutorial, seminar, test class, or higher order level on the basis of course projects, mini projects, or survey. And what are the documents that I am going to prepare for that? First of all, Dr. Calendar, teaching plan, teacher diary, COPO mapping, correlation, whatever I told you, then attendance of the student, then assessment sheets, all assessment sheets. And remember here, a lot of Excel sheets are being generated. And once program is set, automatically, teachers are told to enter, take test and enter marks accordingly. And then attainment sheets. Now, I set a target that within this, after assessment of this, 60% should be the mark average of my students. This is my target set by me. If it is below that, it is not achieved. If it is above, or if it is above regularly for 2 years, it can be raised. So target and level of attainment for COPO are pre-decided, and we need to prepare COPO mapping sheets in each program. For time constraint, I'm not going in detail for this particular metric because I don't want to confuse more, but still for time being, just remember how COs are written, how POs are mapped, how POs are, COs and POs are correlated, POs and PSOs are correlated, and COs are, and COs, POs and PSOs are mapped on based on our say assessment plan, which includes direct assessment, direct attainment, indirect attainment. Direct attainment can be done for the help of course outcomes with using internal evaluation, course outcome using external evaluation, mapping of COs and POs, and along with that, indirect attainment is course end survey or program end survey. So sheets needs to be designed. Here I'm giving you some sample. See, student, CO, then program course outcomes and program outcome. The strength is mapped. This is the student's Excel sheet look like. You can design your own Excel sheet. Exam number, roll number, then test average, then assignment, total percentage, then everything is calculated. These are just screenshots. And after that, you can say CO attainment. CO attainment, what was the target internal score? What was the external score? And simultaneously, the target metrics, how they have been written and how they have been written, and on the basis of it, attainment is prepared. I told you two methods. First method, I told you that CO related and PO related activities and examination are conducted, and attainment is shown because NAC has not prescribed any standard format. Whatever I showed, it is related to NBA guideline, which they have given standards of COPO correlation, mapping their strength, assessment plan, rubrics, and on the basis of it, prepare question paper and map it to percentage. It is going to take time. That already we have discussed that we need a lot of practice for this, but it is not difficult as it seems to be. Once we understand concept, automatically, and that is authentic. So herein, we come to the last question, that is 263, quantitative pass percentage of the student. Finally, number of students appeared for the examination and number of students passed. So here you can see number of students appeared in the final examination and number of students passed in the final examination. You will have to give the ratio. And here, as an additional document or the documentary proof you need to provide, the university, if you are affiliated college, let it be UG or PG, you will have to get certified report of the control of examination of the university. Okay, so that must be certified by the university official. Simultaneously, as an additional information, you can go subject wise, because usually we prepare at our institution the subject wise result, then pass percentage, university merit holder. If the result standards are good, you can additionally support, and you can even highlight to the student who has achieved in the list of merit also. So this is what just I wanted to share. There are so many things that can be shared, but I want to be in time. So I would like to conclude with the last point. which is regularly asked, student satisfaction survey. Remember, student satisfaction survey, 20 plus 1, 20 objective and one open-ended question, and its guideline, how it needs to be done, the banners to be displayed by institution. Everything is made clear by NAC on institutional website, NAC website. But now, as far as AQR is concerned, I would like to just mention that NAC has suggested that institution may design their own or their independent student satisfaction survey questionnaire for the sake of their own convenience, but it must be collected. One, secondly, it must be analyzed, and it must be uploaded on the institutional website, and it and the action taken report, what action has been taken and where it has been presented. So on the day one itself, I have made one or two things clear that it need not be student satisfaction survey, or survey need not be confused with feedback on curriculum, which was discussed yesterday. Okay, this can be, student satisfaction survey can be on, can be designed and developed on the basis of the all the academic, subject related, performance related, or the facility related issues as per convenience, and simultaneously take care that you analyze and reports are updated, because you will be demanded link for that. And better to go for electronic mode now, because the tab can be made available for student satisfaction survey. Instead of using say third party software, you can have your own system, which will help you to analyze the results at earliest without giving or without taking much pains. So this is what just I wanted to have a word with you. I have tried to be self-explanatory, but if there is anything, I will be now or later on anytime, you can feel free to understand. Ma'am, over to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for a really informative and insightful presentation. You have explained every indicator, every point very clearly. Your timely examples have made even the complicated things quite easy to understand. Thank you, sir. With your kind permission, now we shall start with the question answer session. Yes. Sir, actually, along with the session, Pingre sir has already been answering most of the questions. So I will be very selective now in picking up certain questions for which we wish your comments.
Yes.
So the first question is, where to put VJ, NT, SBC and EWS, etc. students? Do they fall in other category?
I would like to answer this question very briefly. At central level, I would request you to go to your office, and you have state government policy. We are governed by the state government. Say, for example, even SBC also, SBC NT. At central level, they don't have SBC, special backward. So if you are filling in the data, check with your management and the office. It can be, or it needs to be added in OBC. Okay, but before finalizing the thing, you consult, because there are many headings. Those who have not been found in central what you call reservation policy list, but in state government, state list, they are there. So even NT also. So this is the frequently asked question, but we suggest that they may be added in OBCs. But before you finalize the thing, you have word with your principal, management, and make a strong policy format. Okay, thank you.
Yes. So the next question is, how to prepare a report of slow and advanced learner? Has NAC given any format for the same? If not, can you share some format?
I hope Kangode sir and even Srihari sir, because Srihari sir is yesterday itself, he was in a mood of sharing so many things. But one thing, NAC hasn't given it. And that's why I intentionally extended my presentation of that particular metric to one or two more slides. Because first of all, understanding threat of that particular category. And secondly, now here IQSCs may take lead, IQSC needs to take lead. And here, the policy, first of all, development of the policy, that how are we going to proceed further in terms of student security. Yahan pe ek question mujhe, like light mode mein mujhe, kyunki do ghante baat kar raha hu to mujhe thoda hasna bhi, khud ko bhi hasna hai. सब पूछते हैं कि यार ये क्लास में अगर हम शिफ्ट लेके जाने लगे तो और हर एक को पूछने लगे ये क्या है वो क्या है, क्लास में पढ़ाना ये सब भरना है तो पढ़ाना कब? ओके, बट रिमेंबर दिस इज द कॉम्प्लीमेंट्री एक्टिविटी, दिस इज नॉट द सेपरेट एक्टिविटी. वी नोबडी नोज अवर स्टूडेंट अदर देन अस ऑटोमेटिकली. सो हियर डोंट मेक इट वन स्टेप प्रोसेस. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल Joshi sir also will throw light on it. First of all, policy and institutional policy and procedure. How are you going to practice it? Second, IQSs need to take lead to design pro forma for that. Pro forma. Where you are, I showed three points. One is cognitive, other is affective, and third is psychomotor. So based on three levels of learning, starting with name of the student, then name of the student, first of all, complete information, serial number, roll number, but entry level marks, the first test one, then testing tool, second, third, you can have it within the first month, okay, which can be called as diagnostic and formative assessment. And on the basis of it, that you can have average and you can design them, but do not take risk of openly declaring this list or displaying this list on the notice board, because this would create vertical divide in the classroom and there might be what you call some psychological issues. So secretly they give them some goody, motivating names, okay, and directly or indirectly you go on carrying or communicating to that particular group that they need some help. So this is the matter of institutional policy and procedure. Over to you, sir.
Very well explained, sir. The next question is about experiential learning. The participant wants you to guide more about experiential learning by giving some examples and also how to document it.
Again, I would suggest that, see, first of all, documentation in terms of documentation part, I will extend it to, because on the last day, I'm going to extensively deal with only documentation and
right, sir.
But as far as this particular concern, experiential learning, go with the theoretical formulation. Your field visit, yesterday, Srihari sir rightly pointed out that there can be internships or internships and other related projects work and everything. But now, in one of the questions that is being asked, number of programs having internships. Okay, now what happens is, especially arts faculty or allied faculty, they don't have projects or surveys or internships as a formal part of curriculum. And there, in that particular question, you are just asked related to the paper that students have to meet. Students need to understand, students have to go for the project as a part of curriculum. But here institution can plan, or we can plan some activities or some visits. And to tell you, one of the institutions have developed their corpus or institutional ceremony fund for students' research projects and visits, industrial visits. Amount is not big, but that institution. And what they do is, they divide students, make some student, a teacher, a coordinator, and they go for some surveys. And those surveys, how they have lived, whatever, say, some 10-15 projects are being conducted, results are prepared, and the best of the project is selected at institutional level for appearing to Avishkar. Avishkar Festival, and consistently, I am witnessing that college is getting or winning 7 to 10 prizes in Avishkar Festival. So this can be linked at multiple levels. This is the need of the time, that teacher, as they give, every teacher, every subject demands different type of experiential learning. Okay, over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. What is the importance of uploaded YouTube lectures in teaching learning process?
Uploaded YouTube lectures, one, teach, student, student get benefit of 24/7 learning. Okay. And simultaneously, whatever concepts, novel concepts you have developed, let them be viral to get to be benefited by even other students also. And one, this is one. Secondly, whatever resources teachers have generated, they are being measured for the purpose of even scoring additional points, marks in that particular metric where you have been asked that resources generated and ICT tools that teachers have been using. Because until and unless when you claim that you have used ICT tools for teaching learning process, what is the outcome of it in the form of such types of videos? Thank you.
So the next question is about grievances. The participant is asking, is verification and revaluation of marks a part of exam grievance?
A verification? Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Even spelling, name, wrong spelling, changing the name, change of the subject, any small. My request to all of you that what you call bagul bua in Marathi, don't have any grand and high mighty feeling in terms of addressing any question. Simple, small practices, but meticulously and with proper or certain frequency, if they are being done, automatically we get a proper, what you call system and output. Yes.
Yes, sir. Now we come to the last question. I hope I'm not missing on any question. The question is about rubrics. Sir, can you please give your inputs on rubrics?
Rubrics, it is the assessment plan, teaching plan, assessment plan, assessment and evaluation plan. What I will do is, I can share you some of the samples of rubrics on even your Telegram group also, how rubrics are prepared, assessment plans are prepared. But dear teachers, wherever assessment, attainment and COPO mapping is being discussed, my experience to some of the autonomous institutes, we have already conducted COPO writing and mapping workshops. There, finally, we had to go with each and every detail. So do not get confused. What I will do is, I will share, instead of explaining, I will share one of the samples of rubrics, how it is prepared and how it is going to be highly benefited to the teacher in long run. Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
So I think first we need to understand why rubrics. And I think then we can go ahead with how rubrics are constructed. For example, there is a huge class and there are many teachers who are evaluating the students. Now, in order to make them on a same page or same platform, you need to decide on what basis you are going to give marks. So segregating this in a tabular format is called as rubrics. Of course, this also should be told to the students. For example, you are evaluating the presentation of the student. So what are the elements in the presentation you're going to look at? Whether you're going to look at the impact of presentation, whether you're going to look at the content of presentation, whether you're going to look at the way presentation is made, whether you're going to look at in the communication skill in the presentation which is being used, whether you're going to look at the quality of input, original input the student has given while presenting. So I think there are various ways. For example, in the activity. So in the activity, what kind of an elements in the activity you are looking at? And if that element is found in that activity, across the board, all teachers should be giving the same marks. So getting the evaluation, knowing the way the students are being evaluated so that it is known to the students, as well as it is known to the multiple teachers who are going to evaluate the same students so that they remain at par. So any rubrics contains a table. On the right hand side, it talks about what we are looking in the evaluation. And on the columnar side, it mentioned how much weightage you are going to give to what we are looking for. For example, excellent presentation slide. We are looking for wonderfully prepared slides. So I think the weightage is X, 2 marks, 3 marks, out of 15 marks, which are available for the evaluation. So rubrics is meant for one, the student understand how he is going to get evaluated, on what basis, and two, these teachers, multiple teachers who are evaluating will remain on the same page. I think there are various examples of the rubric, and every activity can be put into the rubric while doing experiment, whether you are going to give the skill of the experiment marks, whether you are going to give marks for the end result of the experiment, whether you are going to give marks about the procedure, he understands why he is doing doing that procedure. So I think that's the reason why, that is how the rubric is created. So basic principle behind this experiment, the student understand this, his result may be wrong, but he knows the principle, whether you are going to give him marks. He has done it very nicely. So it's an ability to perform experiment, how much marks you're going to give. And end result, if the result is right, what kind of a marks you're going to give. So this all makes sense in creating the rubrics. And I think Dr. Deepak Nanavare can share, I also can share few rubrics. Don't go on the basis of the rubrics which are available online. We'll have to just create our own rubrics so that we understand and evaluate on a similar manner. Thank you.
Thank you, Joshi sir, and thank you, Pingre sir and Kangode sir, for answering the queries in the chat box. Thank you, Nanavare sir, for your valuable comments and for patiently answering all the questions of the participants. With this, we have come to the end of the third day of the faculty development program, and I now call upon Dr. Varsha Malla to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Reena ma'am. It is my privilege to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of Bhavans Hazarimal Somani College of Arts and Science and Jairam Das Patel College of Commerce and Management Studies. I, Dr. Varsha Malla, extend my heartfelt gratitude towards the guest of honor, Dr. Sanjay Jagta, for his valuable presence and insights shared by him on NEC and quality benchmarking in higher education institutes. My sincere thanks to the resource person for the technical session, Dr. Deepak Nanavare sir, for giving us an elaborate idea and effectively shedding light on the various aspects of the most extensive criterion, that is teaching, learning, and evaluation. I'm sure that your guidance will be of great help and value to each one of us in the preparations of Criterion 2, sir. I also thank respected office bearers of LUSA, Dr. Vijay Joshi and Dr. P.N. Paprikar, and resource persons for the FDP, Professor Dr. Vani Laturkar, Dr. Bharat Kangode, and Mr. Srihari Pingle for their valuable presence and active participation in today's session. And we look forward to an enriching learning experience ahead. Last but not the least, I thank all the participants of this FDP and look forward to your active participation in the upcoming days of this FDP. Thank you all. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, madam.
Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Srihari, for a wonderful presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.